Let us pray. Direct us, O Lord, in all our doings, and with thy most gracious favor, Son of us, with all thy continual help, that in all our works, begun and continued and into thee, in thee we may glorify thy holy name, and finally by thy mercy obtain everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our first hymn is included in the two sheets, Awake, Awake to Love and Work. Almighty God, into whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ said. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Lord, we beseech thee, grant thy people grace to withstand the temptations of the world, the flesh, and the devil, and with pure hearts and minds to follow thee, the only God, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated for an Old Testament lesson. Elijah leaves from Jezebel. Here beginneth the 19th chapter of the first book of the Kings. And Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, and withal how he had slain all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger unto Elijah, saying, So let the gods do to me, and more also, if I make not thy life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time. And when he saw that, he arose and went for his life, and came to Bathsheba, which belongeth to Judah, and left his servant there. But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness, and came and sat down under a juniper tree, and he requested for himself that he might die, and said, It is enough. Now, O Lord, take away my life, for I am not better than my fathers. And as he lay and slept under a juniper tree, behold, then an angel touched him and said unto him, Arise and eat. And he looked, and behold, there was a cake baked on the coals, and a cruse of water at his head. And he did eat and drink, and laid him down again. And the angel of the Lord came again the second time, and touched him and said, Arise and eat, because the journey is too great for thee. And he arose and did eat and drink, and went in the strength of that meat 40 days and 40 nights unto Horeb, the mount of God. And he came thither unto a cave, and lodged there. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, and he said unto him, What doest thou here, Elijah? And he said, I have been very jealous for the Lord God of hosts, for the children of Israel have forsaken thy covenant, thrown down thine altars, and slain thy prophets with the sword. And I, even I only, am left, and they seek my life to take it away. And he said, Go forth and stand upon the mount before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind rent the mountains and brake in pieces the rocks before the Lord. For the Lord was not in the wind, and after the wind an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake a fire, for the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire a still small voice. And it was so when Elijah heard it, that he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood in the entry in of the cave. And behold, there came a voice unto him and said, What doest thou here, Elijah? And he said, I have been very jealous for the Lord God of hosts, because the children of Israel have forsaken thy covenant, thrown down thine altars, and slain thy prophets with the sword, and I even only am left, and they seek my life to take it away. And the Lord said unto him, Go, return on thy way to the wilderness of Damascus, and when thou comest, anoint Hazael to be the king over Syria, and Jehu the son of Nimshi shalt thou anoint to be the king over Israel, and Elisha the son of Shaphat of Abel-Mehulah shalt thou anoint to be the prophet in thy room. And it shall come to pass that him that escapeth the sword of Hazael shall Jehu slay, and him that escapeth the sword of Jehu shall Elisha slay. Yet I have left me 7,000 in Israel, all the knees which have not bowed unto Baal, and every mouth which hath not kissed him. So he departed thence and found Elisha the son of Shaphat, who was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen before him, and he with the 12th. And Elijah passed by him and cast his mantle upon him, and he left his oxen and ran after Elijah and said, Let me, I pray thee, kiss my father and my mother, and then I will follow thee. And he said unto him, Go back again, for what have I done to thee? And he returned back from him and took a yoke of oxen and slew them and boiled their flesh with the instruments of the oxen and gave unto the people, and they did eat. And he arose and went after Elijah and ministered unto him. Here endeth the reading.
The epistle is written in the first letter of St. Paul the Apostle to the Corinthians, beginning at the fourth verse. I thank my God always on your behalf for the grace of God, which is given you by Jesus Christ, that in everything you are enriched by him in all utterance and in all knowledge, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you, so that ye come behind in no gift, waiting for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall also confirm you unto the end, that ye may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Here end the epistle.
The 22nd chapter of Matthew, beginning at the 34th verse.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
When the Pharisees had heard that Jesus had put the Sadducees to silence, they were gathered together. Then one of them, which was a lawyer, asked him a question, tempting him and saying, Master, which is the great commandment in the law? Jesus said unto him, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. While the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them, saying, What think ye of Christ? Whose son is he? They say unto him, The son of David. He saith unto them, How then doth David in spirit call him Lord, saying, The Lord said unto my Lord, Sit thou on my right hand till I make thine enemies thy footstool. If David then call him Lord, how is he his son? And no man was able to answer him a word, neither durst any man from that day forth ask him any more questions.
Praise be to thee, O Christ.
Confess our common faith in the words of the Nicene Creed.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God. Made, who for us men and for our salvation.
Please be seated. My, what a good-looking crowd you are today. I was not very hopeful when I saw the rain coming in, but you have come through, and I know we have some outside in the parking lot and others in the pavilion, and we welcome you all. We're glad you're out there and glad you're in here, and it's going to be a glorious Sunday. It already is. We have animal blessing at 3, rain or shine, in the pavilion. Also, we have coming around 2, Bob Lee. Does anyone remember Bob and Gloria Lee, who used to be members of our church? Yeah, I see several people remember. His daughter is bringing them up, and I shall be giving them Holy Communion here at the church. It's his birthday, and we'll be remembering him. Bob's had a stroke, but he has a keen mind, and so, of course, anyone who wants to be here around 2 to see Bob is very welcome to do so. Animal blessing, and then we have coming up this week, Teaching Tuesdays. We're continuing to look at Simply Christian, N.T. Wright's award-winning book, which is kind of a sequel to C.S. Lewis's Mere Christianity. It's a wonderful way of firming up your faith and knowing what you believe and why. And we're having a great study, so please come and join us at 10 o'clock on Tuesday. And then the men's meeting is being delayed to 11:30 to accommodate if the Teaching Tuesday runs over. So we have the men's group will meet also on Tuesday at 11, October 5th. So please mark that. And if you can't be to Teaching Tuesday in person, we have a Zoom session on Wednesday at 6 p.m. And we'll be glad to give you that Zoom code upon request. There's other notices in your pew sheet, Women's Bazaar Workshop, Wine and Cheese Party, now that looks good. Toys for Tot event, and that's coming up on October 15th. Lots going on, so please mark your calendar. And again, we're so glad each one of you are here this morning. One final thing, for the past, 5 or so months, I've been working on this little book. It's really for people preparing for confirmation, but I think it has material that most anybody could might find interesting. It's called A Faith of My Own, Preparing for Confirmation. I'm the author, and it normally sells for $15, but I'll give you a discount. $10 for you, and the money doesn't go to me. It goes to our treasurer, Bob Morgan. He's going to be very cross with me if I don't raise enough money to pay for the printing of this book. So I have to really watch my P's and Q's on that. All right, I have a few copies today, but let me know by next Sunday I'll have hopefully a plethora of copies and be happy to put one in your hands. Our next hymn is 416. 416.
Oh,
Lord, my strength and my redeemer.
Amen.
Please be seated. I failed to say what a wonderful event yesterday's picnic was at Horseshoe Bend. And aren't you glad that the weather was what it was yesterday rather than today's weather? And we do thank the men's group for sponsoring that event, and I think all who attended would be moved to say a good time was had by all. Beautiful scenery, good fellowship, and good food, and a few flies. Have you ever been to a pity party? Been in a place in your life where you were so totally turned in on yourself that you could not think objectively? A time when you wallowed in misery, a time when you were consumed with hopelessness, a time when you found yourself in a hole too deep to climb out of. Well, that is exactly where we find Elijah, the man of God, in this morning's Old Testament reading, at a pity party, first in the desert under a juniper tree, and then hunkered down in a cave. It is enough now, O Lord, take away my life, we hear him say. The ironic thing was that he had just been to the mountain. If you were here last week, you know what that mountain was. There had been this great contest between Elijah and the prophets of Baal, and Elijah's side had come out on top. Let me quickly amend that to say that the contest was not, in fact, between men, between prophets, but rather between the living God and a God who was no God, an idol made with hands. More than that, even the word contest is something of a misnomer. Imagine going to a football game where the opposing team failed to show up. Well, that is exactly what happened at this showdown at Mount Carmel. Baal never showed up. His prophets were there, and all 450 of them. An altar was set up in his name, but Baal himself was nowhere to be found. When the prophets cried to him to send down fire from heaven to consume the sacrifice laid out on the altar, the prearranged sign of his presence and supremacy, he was not there. He was missing in action. But when it came Elijah's turn, just the opposite happened. Fire came down with speed, with such speed and power that no one was left in doubt as to who the real God was. So dramatic the scene that all the people present that day cried out with one voice, "The Lord, he is God, we will serve him." That was Elijah's trip to the mountain. No doubt there was not a little jubilation in Elijah's heart that day, but that was soon to change. By the time today's reading opens, we find him in quite a different state of mind. Instead of being on top of the mountain, he was in the slough of despond. Instead of being in the driver's seat, he was on the run, all because of wicked Queen Jezebel's threat to end his life. Faith and courage had evaporated and had been replaced with fear and cowardice. Before we look at Elijah's less than illustrious response to Jezebel's threat, though, there is something we can learn from this wicked woman. Allow me to explain. sometimes we assume the reason people don't believe, don't become Christians, is because they lack proof. They don't have enough information. From Jezebel, we learn that, in fact, that is not always the case. Sometimes it may be the case, but not always. There is such a thing as a hard and impenitent heart, and Jezebel had just such a heart. The living God had revealed himself in the most dramatic and visible way possible in Israel. Yet this wicked woman, instead of yielding her will to his and abandoning this false God, rather she was determined to carry on, to continue in her sin. Instead of repenting, she set her face in the opposite direction. She vowed mischief on God's spokesman, Elijah. This same unbelief can be seen in the New Testament after the raising of Lazarus of Bethany. Some believed after this dramatic demonstration of God's power, but others did not. We're told that a certain crowd could not contain themselves until they hot-tailed it off to Jerusalem to report what they had seen to the Jewish religious leaders in hopes of getting Jesus into trouble. A three-day-old dead man was no sooner out of the grave than they had their minds set on mischief. Let me say that unbelief of this sort is dangerous, very dangerous. Why? How so? Well, because every time you reject the light that you have been given, every time you close the door to the witness of the Spirit, the harder your heart becomes. And eventually, there comes a time when you no longer see that light, a time when God says, okay, have it your way, a time when God himself closes the door of your heart. We see this in the case of Pharaoh in the days of Moses. Sign after sign was given this ancient potentate, yet he refused to believe and to let the children of Israel go free. The scriptures say Pharaoh hardened his heart. But as the story goes forward, the nomenclature changes. No longer do we hear Pharaoh harden his heart, but rather God hardened his heart. Which was it? Both. Pharaoh hardened his heart, and in the end, God confirmed his choice. He gave him up to unbelief, or what St. Paul calls in Romans 1, a reprobate mind. He said, okay, have it your way. So there is a danger in unbelief and delay. This danger persists down until this present day. The lesson is this. Today, if you hear God's voice, harden not your heart. Today is a day of salvation. Don't delay. But there's a lesson here also for the convinced Christian. I'm thinking about as this Christian seeks to share his faith with others out there in the marketplace of life. From Jezebel, we learn that not everyone will believe, no matter what is said or done, and no matter how skillfully said or done it is. A voice could be heard from heaven, and some will not hear and believe. When this happens, you don't need to blame yourself. If you share what you know about Jesus and someone receives your witness, rejoice and give glory to God. If they do not, don't blame yourself. Give it up unto the Lord. We learn as much from the story of Jezebel. She had the evidence, but still refused to believe and to change her wicked ways. But back to Elijah. Elijah had every reason to trust the Lord. He had every reason to trust God in the situation in which he now found himself. If God could defeat 450 of the prophets of Baal, he could easily take care of one wicked queen. But that is not how Elijah reacted that day, the day after his great mountaintop experience. No, he took his eyes off God and had, as we have already said, a pity party. Yet, and this is the gracious and encouraging thing about this story, God did not abandon him. God provided for his physical, spiritual, and emotional needs. He carried him in this dark period of his life. Perhaps you have heard the little poem or a little story by Mary Stevenson entitled Footprints in the Sand. It's not the best verse, but it has an important message. The words go like this. One night I dreamed a dream. As I was walking along the beach with my Lord, across the dark sky flashed scenes from my life. For each scene, I noticed two sets of footprints in the sand, one belonging to me and one to my Lord. After the last scene of my life flashed before me, I looked back at the footprints in the sand and noticed that at many times along the path of my life, especially at the very lowest and saddest times, there was only one set of footprints. This really troubled me, and so I asked the Lord about it. Lord, you said once I decided to follow you, you'd walk with me all the way. But I noticed that during the saddest and most troublesome times of my life, there was only one set of footprints. I don't understand why, when I needed you the most, you would leave me. He whispered, "My precious child, I love you and will never leave you, never ever during your trials and testings. When you saw only one set of footprints, it was then that I carried you." That is what we find God doing for Elijah that day, carrying him. The reassuring thing is that he will do the same for you and me. If we are faithless, he remains faithful, says St. Paul in 2 Timothy 2:13. That is good news indeed, because we are frail children of dust. We don't all the time live up to our high calling. We too have our weak moments. We too have our pity parties. I don't know what is going on in your life this morning. For all I know, you might be at the end of your tether. You might be on your way to one of those pity parties. If that is the case, and I hope it isn't, remember God's gracious dealings with Elijah. Remember those footprints in the sand. Keep your ears open for the still, small voice of calm. And all will be well. All will be well. And now unto God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost, we ascribe to this most justly due, all might, majesty, dominion, power, and glory, world without end.
Amen.
Remember the words of the Lord Jesus, how he said, "It is more blessed to give than to receive." Not everyone that saith unto me, "Lord, Lord," shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. This time, our few minutes, seconds, our ushers will be coming forward. I would remind those in the parking lot, we have a basket in the pavilion, and we'll be bringing communion around after a bit. You may also give your donation then. Also, we have an online option from our website, www.stlukesblueridge.org, a portal on our internet site, and we appreciate those who use it as well. Our ushers will now come forward.
Please be seated. I beg your prayers for those who celebrate birthdays within this parish family, remembering Robert E. Bob Lee, Matt Roddenberry, Elias Taylor Kilpatrick, Patsy Williams, Todd Lyons, for those who serve in the armed services of our country, in particular those who have connections to this parish church, Kimberly Edelstein, Tyler Ketron, Wesley Ryan McIntosh, Christian Wade Newman, Kyle Morgan, Sam Soon, Jake Baker, Mark Rodriguez, Brooks Johnson, and Jessica Wiley. For those who requested our prayers and whose names are listed in the pew sheet, we pray by name for Rodney Allen, Pam Sebi, Mark Whitty, Charles Sims, Barbara Newman, Andy Lovecooker, Richard and Mercedes Masuko, Elizabeth Ann White, Tim Higdon, Connie Parks, Doc Washburn, Eileen Kerr, Hoot and Gwen Skelton, Ruby Kreska, Bruce Birkinshaw, Pat and Sharon Deering, Tom Hofer, Ann Thomason, Sally Hess, Marilyn Kiffmiller, Roseanne Johnston, and Jackie Lumpkin. Let us pray for the whole state of Christ. Almighty and ever-living God, who by thy holy apostle has taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all men, we humbly beseech thee most mercifully to accept our alms and oblations and to receive these our prayers which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word, and live in unity and godly love. We beseech thee also so to direct and dispose the hearts of all Christian rulers, that they may truly and impartially administer justice to the punishment of wickedness and vice, and to the maintenance of thy true religion and virtue. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and other ministers, that they may both by their life and doctrine set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. And to all thy people give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor all those in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed this life and thy faith and fear, Jean Woodruff, beseeching thee to grant them continual growth in thy love and service, and to give us grace so to follow their good examples, and that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant this, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate.
Amen.
Ye who do truly and earnestly repent of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbors, and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to your comfort and make your humble confession to Almighty God, devoutly kneeling. Almighty God,
Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed, against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us.
We do earnestly repent, and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us, the burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in the midst of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, hear this great mercy, have promised forgiveness of sins to all those with hearty repentance and true faith turning to Him. Have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear what comfortable words our Savior Christ saith unto all who truly turn to Him. Come to me, all ye that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. So God loved the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all that believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Hear also what St. Paul says. This is the true saying, and worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Hear also what St. John says. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins. Lift up your heart.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God.
It is meet and right, so to do.
It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Everlasting God. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of thy glory. Glory be to thee, O Lord most high.
Oh, glory be to thee, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, for the thou of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there, by his one oblation of himself once offered, a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world. And in institute, and in his holy gospel, command us to continue a perpetual memory of that his precious death and sacrifice, until his coming again. For in the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it, in remembrance of me. Wherefore, Lord and Heavenly Father, according to the institution of thy dearly beloved Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, we, thy humble servants, do celebrate and make here before thy divine majesty, with these thy holy gifts which we now offer unto thee, the memorial thy Son hath commanded us to make, having in remembrance his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, rendering unto thee most hearty thanks for the innumerable benefits procured unto us by the same. And we most humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, to hear us, and of thy almighty goodness vouchsafe to bless and sanctify with thy word and Holy Spirit these thy gifts and creatures of bread and wine, that we, receiving them according to thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. And we earnestly desire thy fatherly goodness, mercifully to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins in all the benefits of this passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee. Humbly beseeching thee that we and all others who shall be partakers of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ, be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and made one body with him, that he may dwell in us, and we in him. And although we are unworthy through our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
We do not deserve to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness,
but in thy bold and great mercies, we are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table, but thou art the standing, Lord, whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, and that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may ever work well in him, and he in us.